Okay, the next job is to put the mixer or the outlets on. So this is a bit strange. I got this hand wash basin from Australia's biggest outlet, hardware outlet. It's got a sort of a curved domed area where you put the mixer. The mixer only just is wide enough to cover this area. There's no need for a curved bit. There needs to be a sharp, square, round edge. Also put the outlet for the bath. I've got this laundry trough outlet. The reason I've got that is that it can fall back against the wall. And when you've got little babies or kids in it, they don't come up with their head and smash their head against an iron or steel outlet. I've also got the tap located high enough so that a child or a kid can't smash their head on a tap. Okay, so now I've got the shower outlet. It's, you know, the hose. The shower outlet rests in that catcher there. And so you can remove it, and if you're going to clean your shower, you can get the shower head, turn it around, clean the walls. As well as that, I'm going to be painting the ceiling. So I'll be doing a bit of patching, and I'll paint it now so that I don't get paint all over my outlets. And I'll put some drop sheets around on the tiles, just so that I don't get paint on anything at all. Everything else is covered from the previous covering work, so that's all good to go. Okay, I've decided to take the precaution and just put drop sheets all around the walls. That's just so that I don't get any splashes or drops on the tiles. Okay, so I'm using bathroom paint. It's got antibacterial additives in it. Very expensive, about close to $80 for 4 litres. But I think it's going to pay off in the long run, because you get all sorts of mould and bacteria on the ceiling because of the dampness. Okay, so I've got this kitchen and bathroom semi-gloss. I couldn't find gloss, but semi-gloss will be okay. I've given it a shake before I took the lid off, but you can still see there that there's a fair amount of separation. So I'll give it a stir as well. Thank you.
I've just got a piece of thread and I've wound it in until it's tight. And I'll just put a piece of tape on it and then I'll be able to know my thread size.
Okay, so now I've got my thread length. I'll just cut it here and reinstall it and attach the shower supporter. Okay, so I cut the thread to length using this metal cutter, and I just wasn't easy. There isn't much thread, so I just held it, and I wore a protective helmet, gloves, and everything else you need. And I use this grinder just to make a smooth edge. Okay, so I've put my plumber's tape on the join, and I'm using the thick gauge plumbing tape, and I've just made sure that it's seated properly. It's all good. Okay, so I'm just checking that it meets flush here at the cap. Now I'll take it off and put my plumber's tape on. So I've got about 16 mil. So with my cover on, I add that to the length of the thread. Thank you. Okay, there's a cistern outlet, and that just involves putting on this slightly more stylish tap. And I realise it's going to sit away from the wall, but that's okay, it's behind the toilet base. And I'll just go ahead and install this tap. Okay, the third and last coat on the ceiling. Always put it on fairly thick, spread it out. Just make sure it's all finished in the same direction. And no edges or streaks. It's all good. Okay, it's now time to install the toilet base and the cistern, and I also have to connect this to the ceramic plumbing system under the bathroom, so I'll go ahead with that now. There's a ceramic plumbing system under the house, and earlier on in the videos I showed putting this rubber cap on the old ceramic outlet. And that's an adaption to the PVC. That slips in there, down at the base, like that. And the PVC continues into the ceramic outlet. This is a swivel type top that connects to the toilet. And you can turn it, and it it adjusts itself to the right position. Okay, so I'll drop that in the PVC. What I'll do now is I'll put the toilet in position, and I'll be able to find out where I've got to attach the cap. Okay, so I've got my mark. I know for sure that it's got to be glued here, so I'll get a CD marker and I'll just mark it like that. I'll glue it up and I'll know how to position it. Okay, with plumbing you use a what they call a sort of a plumbing solution or fluid or a primer. You put the primer on and then you put your glue on top of that. So I'll just prime it. Now, primed the wrong side, but it doesn't matter in this instance. Okay, this has to be done fairly quickly, so I'm just going to glue it up now. Okay, so I'll just line up the positions there. Okay, I'm going to go a little bit past the mark, and that's it. Just a reminder at this stage, just keep all your glues, your cements, adhesives, anything that goes off or hard or cures, keep them new. Keep them and then use them the next year. Keep them fresh and new, and you shouldn't have any problems. Okay, so I've sat around and I've planned enough, and I've given myself enough time to come up with a good approach, and I have to get this straight. For instance, what I'm going to do to get it parallel with the wall is just to measure out from the wall on either side, that way I'll know that it's positioned right. I've got my level that way and that way to check it, and as well, so that I know that the cistern's positioned properly, I've got these screws that connects the cistern to the base of the toilet. I'm going to make sure that those two pins on either side are positioned, and that everything, so I know everything's lined up underneath, so the cistern water can flow out. As well as that, to get it level, I've got these adjusters, I've got different sizes, and I'm going to position them underneath the toilet. Okay, so I know that the toilet's fairly well positioned at the moment, so I'm going to make a mark at the front of the toilet, because what's going to happen soon is I'm going to mix up some cement, and I'm going to put it on a foundation of cement, and I want to be able to position it as well as possibly, as quick as possible. Okay, I've got the very best cement I can get, and it's brand new. So I've said before, always keep your cements and glues, etc., keep them new. And I'm going to have a good strong mix of 50 cement and 50 of sand. Okay, so I'll need about one bucket. Okay, so that's it. That should be a successful job. I've got some bricks holding it level. I found that when I packed it out behind that it wouldn't really stay there properly. So I've got those bricks holding it. And you know, I've taken precautions, like I've forced the cement underneath and packed it out. You can see here that the cement's come out of the hole here, which means that it's filled well. And on the other side, so I've sponged around and cleaned up around the other side. I've made sure that the system sits against the wall. See there, that's pretty well flush against the wall on both sides. So if I, you know, push it back, it won't move, so that's sitting against the wall. So yeah, that's it. So it's level that way, the system is against the wall. It's supported underneath with hard new cement, and yeah, that should be a good job. Yeah, so it's a fairly long day. I've got plenty of mess to clean up. It's amazing how many tools you need. I suppose that's sort of why it's so hard for the, you know, the person who doesn't have many tools to do any of this work. You just need hundreds of tools. Okay, it's 15 hours later. It's the next morning. And if you mix it up half cement and half sand, just remember that the next morning is going to be real hard. I've used good quality cement and I've mixed it up 50%. Sand, 50% cement, and that, as you can see, that's really hard the next morning. So don't forget to just do any cleaning properly. Just if you've got any tape, just lift it up and just sponge it off, and any supports will have to be ground off at ground level. The tiles are going over these. I can't get these out. They don't have to come out, so I'll just grind them flat. But don't forget to clean up around the edge before you call it a day, because you know, that's rock solid.